I'll have a venti dolce caramel macchiato with no ice.
Speak English when you talk to me, okay?
I'll have a venti caramel dolce.
What is that?
A large?
So say that next time, okay?
You were also researching a tea videos, correct?
What? What did you just say?
That's what you were researching.
Correct? Say it again.
Thank you for coming today. If you want to be forgiven, you must first confess your sins.
To me. Well, show me. What you just said, I've never seen that in Discovery. I've been incarcerated 3 years. You never showed that to my team. Where did you get that?
It's in your phone.
Do it, show it.
Oh, don't take the f*** away, man. I thought it was that. The f*** me. The f*** with the best.
Have you ever wanted to be famous? Growing up, that wasn't exactly the plan that Ali Abulaban's parents had in mind for him, but it was clear from a young age that their son was a performer and he liked dancing and making people laugh.
I was in Miami one day. I went to go buy cookies.
Now, if you ask his mother, she would describe Ali as hyper but talented, saying also that he would get in trouble at school because he couldn't sit still, sometimes having emotional outbursts or throwing items. Ali grew up in a very strict household, and his family lived in fear of Ali's father. Ali even physically fought with his father, starting from as young as 14 years old. In one incident in particular, his mother remembers Ali playing Guitar Hero and his father allegedly snatching the plastic guitar away and smashing it over Ali's head. So Ali ran away the first chance he got to Okinawa, Japan, after enlisting in the US Air Force at just 18 years old. And it was on the sunny shores of Okinawa that Ali met Anna. Beautiful, vibrant, full of life Anna. Growing up with a tight-knit friend group in the Philippines, Anna didn't know what to expect when she first moved to Okinawa. But her father's job with the military meant Japan was her new home, and thanks to her warm, bubbly personality and fun-loving attitude, it was easy for her to adapt and make friends. And it was here in 2014 that she met Ali, an Air Force pilot, a singer in a band, a total hottie, as they say. People would say that they looked like the perfect couple. But as we all know, social media appearances are one thing and real life is another, because as it turns out, behind the scenes in this relationship, Ali was turning into somebody unrecognizable. Someone that only very few could have guessed was even capable of what would happen next.
Tony, how could you do this, Tony? Do you understand what you have
the guy?
What are you high or what? Have you been listening to anything I said?
But first, oh hi, hello, it's Swoop, and welcome to the dark waters of the sus pool, the place where everything and everyone is sus. Or is it us? Come on in, the water's fine. Welcome back, Suspirians. I hope you're doing well. If you couldn't tell, I'm feeling very citrus today, okay? So we're going with it. These are actual, legitimately real orange slices, kind of obsessed, okay? Trying to brighten the mood here. Because today, I've got another case of social media fame spiraling desperately out of control in honestly the worst way possible, and I've got a lot of thoughts on this story. Now, if you're new here, welcome. This is my second channel. On my main channel, Swoop, I do full-length deep dives and documentaries, and over here, we take a lighter dip into the dark waters of the bizarre, twisted, sometimes scary, always sus stories, while often trying to figure out who or what belongs in the sus pool, if anything or anyone, or maybe is it us? Did we guess wrong as the story was going? So, my dear sister, feel free to guess along with us in the comments about where the true sus is. And as the story unfolds, let's find out if our first guess was correct, if there's more to the story than meets the eye, all of those things. And if you're into mind-bending, dark, and twisted tales, subscribe to this channel, bring a towel, and go ahead and just like tickle the like button, okay? She can be a little shy, but she loves a good little tickle under the chin. Rumor has it, so I've been told. Okay, in a sec, we're gonna dive into this, but first, how are you feeling? Like, is anyone else feeling exhausted with like an endless list of things to do and no time to get it all done? By the end of the day, I am completely worn out, and the last thing I want to have to do is decide on dinner and then cook. Like, the very idea of having to go to the grocery store, meal prep, and cook just to have to then do the dishes. Which is why I love Factor. Factor makes meeting your nutrition goals fast and easy by delivering fresh, never frozen, dietitian approved meals right to your front door. Every meal is delicious and ready to go in just 2 minutes. Yes, please. Factor has saved me so much time and stress. Like, I've been using them for months now and every meal is incredible. All you have to do is heat and enjoy and have more time doing the things that you love. And the meal options are so freaking good. Factor has over 35 meals to choose from per week, including options like keto, calorie smart, vegan and veggie, and many more. And you can also choose from more than 60 add-ons every week, like breakfast, on-the-go lunch, snacks, and the most delicious juices. So it's more than just dinners. You can fuel your body all day long. Like, I had the most amazing garlic mushroom chicken one night and the most delicious jalapeno lime cheddar chicken with spicy cilantro cauliflower rice the next. And they are so good. And better yet, you can skip the overpriced takeout trap. Factor is cheaper and better tasting with chef-crafted restaurant quality meals delivered right to your door. And if life starts getting chaotic, Factor is flexible. You can easily change your order up every week, pause or reschedule your delivery at any time. In all the months I've been eating Factor, I've literally never had a single bad dish. And great news, because Factor is now owned by HelloFresh, and with a wider array of meal plans to choose from, there's something for everyone. I actually enjoy switching between the brands, and now my viewers, all of you, can enjoy both brands at a discount with me. So if you want the joy of not having to think about your meals, saving time, money, and skipping the grocery store, head to factor75.com or click the link below and use code SWOOP250 to get 50% off your first Factor box and 20% off your next month of orders. That's code SWOOP250, T-O-O-5-0 at factor75.com to get 50% off your first box plus 20% off your next month of orders. And treat yourself, honey, you deserve it. Okay, grab your nose plugs and let's dip in to the cesspool.
Can you even smoke in here?
I don't care. Who's gonna stop me? I like you. I want you to be the love of my life. How do you like that?
But we just met yesterday.
So what?
I mean, do you even know anything about me?
No, but I like your eyes. They never lie. You're beautiful. All these guys, they want you. Long black hair, what else?
I mean, that's all you got?
Oh my God. Why don't you try sticking your head up to her? See if it fits.
You f***ing!
Oh my God. Come back, I was just kidding, man. Fuck. What you looking at, man?
Okay, question. If you're in a relationship, how well do you think you know your partner? Like, do they ever get jealous? Do you ever get jealous? What do you think your friends would say about your relationship? Anna's friends noticed that her boyfriend, Ali, got jealous a lot, and he didn't like it when others commented on Anna's looks. Now, let's be honest, Anna is stunning. Like, of course people are going to compliment her and she deserves the compliments. But Ali had a problem with that. And to her friends, he seemed a little controlling. But Anna dismissed their concerns. And she and Ali didn't stay in Okinawa for very long anyways, because Ali was discharged from the Air Force for his conduct and forced to leave the island. The charge against him? Domestic assault. Yeah, the sus is already simmering in the pot, isn't it? It was a drunken incident, not that alcohol is ever a valid excuse, where he very sadly beat Anna in front of others after a night out at a bar. He did this in front of witnesses, but sadly again, Anna stuck by Ali's side, as so many victims often do for any number of reasons. So there's absolutely no shame in Anna making that decision. A lot of us have made that decision in the past. Now, while dating, Anna discovered that she was pregnant with Ali's child, and she had a choice to make, ultimately choosing to marry Ali in a courthouse wedding and settle in the suburbs of Virginia with their newborn daughter. After leaving the military, Ali found a new job as an IT contractor, but he was also working on his secondary passion. Basically, whatever the hell this is.
My father once told me that if you can fix a blade, My father once told me that if you can fix a blade, you can fix anything. Need something? Have a look. You keep your filthy hands to yourself, thief. You keep your filthy hands to yourself, thief.
Now, some people called it comedy, and after spamming the internet with video after video after video, one of Ali's I don't even know how to pronounce it, I'm so sorry, people. One of those skits finally went viral, and Ali was starting to get some big social media shout-outs from creators like Jenna Marbles, of all people. I mean, you know, before she went offline, you know, end of an era over there. And also, he was branching out into other content, like impressions of celebrities and famous characters like Al Pacino, Nicolas Cage, 6ix9ine, but his favorite character?
Antonio Montana. And you? What'd you call yourself?
Listen, buddy, I'm the only one that asks questions around here, pal. Got it?
Let's hear the Pledge of Allegiance. Okay. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America.
Yeah, so that's supposed to be Tony Montana, the cocaine-obsessed, drug-dealing character from the iconic 80s film Scarface, played by Al Pacino. If I gotta see these, you do too, so here's another one.
How'd you like that, huh? You f***ing let it go! You think you're gonna take me? You need a f***ing army, you're gonna take me, you hear? Girl, I think you have to f***ing help! Girl, girl, go to me!
I can't understand a good word that he's saying, and I don't give a if I sound petty right now, you will see why soon enough. But I guess Ali's idea of good acting is, I don't know, yelling? I don't really know. I'm not the target demographic, obviously. But all of this, like, yelling spawned the era of Ali's YouTube and TikTok stardom, where he went by the alias Jin Kid. Sometimes Anna would film the videos for Jin Kid, but sometimes she would be in them, and when she was, people in the comments wanted to see more of her. She eventually started her own TikTok account and gained a large following there, as well as on Instagram, where she became a verified account, and to what I've been able to find, seems like she had almost 2 million followers. Most of her content revolved around her life having fun with friends and raising Amira. So as you might expect, Ali starts to feel sidelined and gets jealous. And Anna was looking for ways to branch out. She was totally isolated in Virginia, away from family and friends. And Anna convinced Ali to move their family to San Diego, where a lot of her friends from Okinawa wound up moving to, and they moved into an apartment called Spire, a high rise overlooking the downtown area near lots of nightlife, which was great for Anna. Like, she could finally be with her friends and get out of their very isolated home. But guess how Ali felt about that? Yeah, Ali didn't like it when he wasn't the center of attention. Like, shock balls, right? And to, I guess, really massage his acting muscles, Ali was still doing his Scarface impressions, except this time he became a method actor, I guess, doing like bumps of actual cocaine on live streams and openly taking hits in movie theaters and restaurants, according to his friends. And the fame on TikTok, I guess, got to his head, because there's nothing we like more than a TikTok influencer getting the fame going straight to the head and thinking that somehow it's more than it is, because his behavior got more out of control, especially towards Anna. He would threaten to take his own life when Anna would say that she wanted to leave him, and he would pull out his gun in their home around their daughter. As you can imagine, Anna felt unsafe at home, and like, of course she did. Like, literally her husband, this TikTok famous Scarface guy with, like, you think about the Scarface character when they're just like, wait, say hello to my little friend, all that shit. Again, I'm not the target demographic for that film, but he's just waving a gun around her and her child. Like, I would be freaking the out, right? And he wouldn't stop there. Ali would literally broadcast their fights on live streams and call her a bitch on stream, putting all of this behavior right out in the open.
And I can't wait to divorce you so I can start my new life. And you're gonna watch Netflix one day, and you're gonna see my face on Netflix.
Hey, isn't that your husband?
So you're gonna see my face for the rest of your life.
And listen, like, before anyone jumps up and says, but why didn't she just leave? You know, y'all know we talk about this on the main channel all the time. Like, we don't play that game. Like, victims stay with abusers for all kinds of reasons. Like, it's rarely ever that simple as, like, why don't you just leave? I can't not say this. Like, if you are in a harmful situation and you need help, please know that there are free resources to help online. If you do use these resources, please do clear your browser history history after looking at them. If you feel like your activity is being monitored and could put you in danger, and please do get out if you safely can. There is hope. I hope that you are able to take those measures. But here's the thing. Anna's immigration status in the United States meant that getting a divorce would jeopardize her ability to stay in the country, and she would have to leave her daughter behind. Like, Anna couldn't stomach that idea. Who could? Especially leaving her daughter with that, right? Ali would threaten to have Anna deported if she didn't. Can you imagine literally being threatened by your partner who's supposed to love you, that they're gonna have you deported if you try to protect yourself? You know, let's be honest, the sus is all up his ass right now, and I don't like it. So yeah. Now, unfortunately, as time went on, Ali's jealousy only escalated, and he became paranoid that she was cheating on him and was convinced that she was sleeping with her friend Rayburn. Now, just to make sure that we focus on all of the people who matter the most in this story, you're gonna hear more about Ray, which is short for Rayburn. Rayburn has been described by those closest to him as an amazing brother and son who always put family first, and you know, someone who is a very loyal friend who could always be counted on if you were in need. And I think that's always important to have a little bit of context about someone. And I think given what Anna was going through with Ali, it only makes sense that Rayburn, who, you know, was known for helping his friends, was a around to help support Anna. Now, one day, Anna's friends noticed bruising on her face, and she confessed that Ali had been physically harming her for a long time, starting back when she married him and moved to Virginia.
She said that that her husband was beating her and that he ran off with her phone. So.
Now, San Diego police had been called to their home before for DV, but each time, Ali would talk them out of it or make it seem like Anna had a drug problem and was hanging out with a bad crowd, which honestly, like, I know we only have so much to go by, so much information, but what the hell, officer on call? And like, I don't often say that. I know that we have a lot of feelings about police. I've had experiences, again, coming from, you know, I have survived DV. I have not great experiences, to say the least, but I still try to like reserve some hope and respect, because I do appreciate the good officers out there, and there are some good ones. It's just there sure seem to be a ton of bad ones that make people never want to even bother calling the police. I'm just kind of like, what the hell are we doing here? So Ali was here headed into a coke-fueled spiral, and his paranoia ended in peak irony, actually, when he cheated on Anna. Ain't that some twisted, hypocritical susbag foolery? After all of his needy, whiny, controlling texts about Anna hanging out with her friend Ray, Ali met a woman in their apartment complex and cheated with her. But not until he had done, you know, a few of those lines of the white stuff in front of her, because, you know, gotta stay on brand, bro. Okay, we get the Al Pacino, we're doing the whole Scarface, yeah, cool. And when Anna found out, it was the final straw. In a now-deleted TikTok, Anna makes a video saying that Ali is abusive and that she's leaving him. So, winner, winner, your dinner, daddy. Now, she didn't keep the video up for long, but the damage was already done, and well-deserved for him, might I add. But on the other side of this, she had posted the truth that threatened the one thing that Ali loved the most. It wasn't her, it wasn't their daughter, but it was his online reputation. Yeah, classic. So Ali moves into another apartment during their early separation, but he secretly makes a copy of the electronic key to the old apartment that they shared. And in those weeks, he tries to woo Anna into taking him back and gives her some cheap grocery store roses, which, yeah, because that will totally make up for years of being a dumpster dip. And in a fit of rage one day, Ali heads to their old apartment, waits until Anna leaves, and then vandalizes it, which is recorded.
So I just texted Anna. She said she's at home. I'm at home. She's lying. She's lying. Oh my God, she's lying. Oh my God, she's lying, dude. She's lying. She's cheating. She's cheating on me. She's cheating on me. Oh my God. She's lying. I can't believe it. As I expected, she's cheating on me. She said she's home, she's not home. She just blocked me because I wanted to find out where she is. She won't answer my call. Sorry, Anna.
Now, all that rummaging you hear is Ali ransacking the apartment and making a mess and like throwing away Anna's stuff. And just before leaving, he spotted his daughter's iPad on the floor and decided that he could install an app that would allow him to spy on Anna and see if she really was cheating on him. And I'm gonna use the word cheating very loosely at this point, because honestly, like, I didn't even wanna like dig into if that was happening or not, because I don't even care. Like, what he was putting her through, I don't even care. If she could find happiness somewhere with somebody, and I'm not gonna allege or say that she was or wasn't, but if she could, if she had been able to, more power to her. That's all I gotta say. I don't care. Like, she had to break away from him and get free of him. Like, he I don't care. And so for him to go to these lengths, like putting a spy app on their daughter's iPad to try to listen, like, give it up, dude. Like, you suck. Just admit you suck and move on. That's all you had to do. Just admit you suck and move on. But he wouldn't. And he even angled the iPad in such a way to try to catch Anna doing something that he, you know, was just assuming was happening. And I'm just like, what a pissant loser behavior, right? Listen, again, if you are in a toxic situation and you safely can do so without the fear of repercussions, please check your devices for monitoring apps. Again, only if this won't put you in any further danger. If you do find one, maybe don't delete it, because that could tip them off, and I don't know if that could make them prone to violence. I don't know any situations that any of you might be in. I hope none of you are in this situation, but just be mindful and know that you do have options. And if you find some type of spying app, take a breath. Please talk to someone that you trust or an outside authority that can hopefully help you. So, after installing the spy app, Ali goes home and later wakes up to Anna's voice along with another man's. So she's back at the apartment with a man, and Ali is listening in through the spy app, and he hears them, he allegedly making, you know, poking fun at him or making fun of flowers. And Anna says that she's going to get a restraining order against Ali. And suddenly then they start playing R&B music and the conversation just kind of stops, or you can't hear it very well. So enraged, mind swirling with whatever possibilities are the consequences of your own actions, Ali leaps out of bed and just kind of white knuckles the steering wheel, driving at over 90 miles an hour on the way to Anna's apartment, hoping to catch them in the act. Remember, he had secretly made a copy of the key. Oh, by the way, did I mention he was doing huge bumps of the white stuff basically the whole time? He called it double nostriling, meaning he's straight up sticking his face in the bag, like just unhinged behavior. And again, I'm still not gonna give you that as an excuse for your behavior. So he's barreling down the road, he gets to the apartment, storms into the place, just barges in and saw Anna and Ray together on the couch, according to him. And from that moment, things would never be the same. On October 21st, 2022, Ali Aboulaban murdered his wife, Anna, and her friend Rayburn Barone in cold blood, high on the white stuff and high on his ego and fueled by intense jealousy. Now, the moments during and after were actually recorded by a Nest security camera in the hallway of the apartment building. And listen, we're not gonna play it here. That recording is available, but I will just kind of explain it, because I don't wanna, you know, play something obviously of those moments. It's awful. But basically, he opens the door to the apartment, and within just moments, you hear gunshots. 1, 2, 3, 4. Then you hear what sounds like Anna scream, and it only lasts for just a brief second because it's cut short by shot number 5, then a pause, and then one more shot. And then you hear Ali screaming her name 4 times. I don't really know what else to say other than how heartbreaking it is. I mean, they didn't, Anna and Rayburn didn't even have a chance. Like, it was literally like a few seconds, and then that's it. Didn't even have a chance. Now, in the recording, Ali actually actually enters and exits the apartment a few times. Like, he's deciding kind of like what to do and then pretends to discover Anna. Now, he quickly fled the scene in his car, but not before doing something also truly just so disgusting, which we'll get into in a bit. And also not before running into his old neighbor in the elevator, where you can see him like smiling on his way out.
And you can see in this photograph the defendant smiling.
Yes.
After a short police chase, he was apprehended by the San Diego police. Now, inside the car, they found a gun with 9mm ammunition, and they also found his daughter inside the car. Now, she's okay, she's unharmed, but this obviously is just the beginning of an incredibly traumatic situation for her, not to mention the fact that Ali told his daughter that he hurt her mom and that he's gonna be going away.
When I knew that I was found, and I was about to pull over, I said, "Mommy, I hurt Mommy. I have to go away now."
So police force their way into the apartment, where they discover Ray and Anna, both with gun wounds to the head, kind of slumped over one another on the couch in her home. And at that point, Ali had already confessed, because the first thing that he did after taking Anna's life and taking Ray's life, the first thing that this man did was confess in a phone call to his mom. He's literally in the apartment after what he had just done, calls his mom and confesses. Now, in case he hasn't just hurt people enough with this crime, what he's done, he didn't stop at just a phone call to his mom. No, no, no. This absolute just monster also took photos of Anna and Ray's bodies after he took their life and sent the f***ing photos to his poor mother. I am livid every time I think about this part of the story. I mean, the whole thing, obviously, but like, to put his mother through that, like, as if his parents didn't have enough sudden, just the rest of their lives are forever changed by this. He forced his own mother to look at photos. She's not expecting these photos. So he forced her to look at these photos of what he had done to sweet, beautiful Anna and Rayburn. And I can't think of anything more selfish and cruel than him doing that to his mother, right? Now, as he was fleeing, Ali also called 911, saying that he did so in hopes that Anna and Rayburn could be saved. Though, I mean, if you wanted to save them, then maybe not going there at all, let alone with a gun, would be a pretty damn good way to do that. But anyways, here's where things really get just absolutely unhinged. So fast forward, we're gonna fast forward almost 2 years later, and I'm sure you can guess from some of the clips that I've played earlier that Ali was arrested and about to go on trial for the double side of Anna Abulaban and Rayburn Barone.
And Ali is charged with two counts of first degree murder and faces life in prison. If convicted, the death penalty is also on the table. His next court date is set for next month.
But back in the jailhouse, Ali, y'all, this man, and I use that term very loosely, it takes a lot for me to call him a man, was still running his very loud, very dumb mouth. In an exclusive interview with Fox 5, while behind bars, very, you know, Jodi Arias inspired, this man decided that he wanted to tell his side of the story once again.
So he installed a listening device on their daughter's iPad and used it to spy on his wife.
Yeah, I was listening on the house with the iPad and the red phone.
So when you heard Rayburn's voice, you went to...
I didn't recognize him. I didn't know who it was.
But what were you thinking?
I was freaking out. Oh, my God, I caught her. I caught her. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. There's a man. There's a man. And then guess what? I hear. Nightmare. Nightmare. Are you behind me behind? I'm like, don't do it. I'm screaming.
As you're driving to the apartment... What happens when you get to the apartment?
First of all, this man talks about R&B music like it's the spawn of Satan when there are actual evil things that happened here that he did. Now, in this interview, he totally changes up his story, claiming that he walked in and found Ray on his couch kissing Anna, and he just snapped, blaming the white stuff and blaming Anna. Like, basically, he blames everyone and everything but himself. To him, the cesspool are the victims. To him, the cesspool is the white bumps, right? Like, everything is sus except him. That's why I say, or is it us? Because I'm talking about you, Ali. Now, when questioned about his young daughter, he's basically like emotionless, just explaining himself as if he was picking up a pet or, you know, from doggy daycare.
Got picked up from school, so I could drop her off at a safe location at my dad's wife's brother, who lived an hour away, but police surrounded me on the highway.
Why did you pick her up?
I picked her up.
From school, why did you pick her up from school?
Why wouldn't I?
Why wouldn't I? Maybe because you just took two people's lives from them? Like, he doesn't say that he misses his daughter or that he regrets doing this to Anna and Rayburn, and I'm gonna keep saying their names because their names are more important than anyone's in this story. But like, he does say that he regrets losing out on his big shot at Hollywood stardom. I'm sorry, y'all know petty is my coping mechanism, and man, does this guy try my patience. There are literal tears in his eyes when he talks about losing his potential career.
The weekend before all this happened, I was in LA at the Comedy Store. I was talking to producers. I was about to have a talent agent. It was right there!
He's clearly more upset by the loss of his career than the loss of his wife. You know, this was just all about me, 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 my stuff, my home, my daughter, my couch, my career, my wife.
Were you feeling any remorse about this situation?
I'm broken, I'm devastated, I lost my wife. My goal was to just try to get a hold of my family. It was slipping through my fingers. I'm the loser here. I lost the love of my life. I lost the love of my life.
I literally can't even find the words. I am so pissed off right now. The way he blames Anna, blames his family, which first of all, asshat. Like, if your parents didn't care about anything, why did you call your mom and confess and say, I'm sorry, mom, over and over again? But then the way that he starts hyping himself up.
Everybody I reached out to when I was going through this problem, when I couldn't get a hold of Anna. Dude, you gotta leave her, you gotta leave her. I know I gotta leave her, but I don't wanna leave her. Dude, you're so handsome, you're famous on the internet, you can get any model. I know I can!
Saying his friends say, oh, he's so handsome, so famous, he can get any girl he wants. And he's saying, I know, look at me, I'm hot shit, right? That's the vibe he's given. I'm just like,
dude, you're so handsome, you're famous on the internet, you can get any model. I know I can, I don't want to, I want my wife.
Shut up, dude. So now comes time for Ali's trial. And you know what, actually, okay, I don't even think I wanna say his name anymore. So I'm just not going to. So opening statements for this troglodyte monster who took the innocent lives of beautiful Anna and Rayburn began in late April 2024, and pretty much nobody was on his side.
A longtime friend of Anna's took the stand Monday, claiming behind the scenes of Gin Kid, the violent demeanor was real, even years before he rose to TikTok stardom.
This whole Scarface act was very common back then as well. He just always had to be better than everybody else in the room. He spoke down to a lot of us. It actually kind of made me distance myself toward the end because I just couldn't stand being around him. He made everybody in the room feel uncomfortable. It was just very physical and verbal.
It didn't take long for the courtroom to get a glimpse into his controlling, unhinged, unbelievably arrogant personality after his repeated angry outbursts in court.
Anna inviting Ray to over to the hotel that she was staying at.
Okay, Mr.
Bolivar?
Yes, sir. I'm sorry, this is news to me.
Excuse the out of me, did he just call his wife the mother of his child, the woman he says he loved, the woman whose life he took a bitch again? I mean, you were saying it on your stream, so I guess why not just say it in the courtroom after you took her life? I just, sorry, y'all, listen, I know that there's, you know, like a history of like him and the emotional outburst and stuff, but essentially I look at him like this. He was capable of trying to have this social media career, building content, getting married, having a child, serving in the military. He was perfectly capable of doing those things. So I'm not going to give him this whole, well, you know, when he was growing up as a kid, he had emotional outbursts. The way this story looks to me, he was on top of his emotional outbursts when he needed and wanted to be, when it served him to make his social media content and to work in the military, to work a job, to hang out with his friends. He was capable of controlling it when it served him. And when it served him to be an asshole, he chose to be an asshole. That's just kind of how I see this. So anyways, the thing about this is the small like pissant behavior of an excuse for a man is he would go on and on and on about how he was mentally ill from being on drugs, which obviously, yes, drugs can mess with the mind. But he argued that he shouldn't be held responsible because of his choice to do blow, blah, 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 words, words, words. I am not in the mood to entertain this. Like, if we start entertaining that, can you imagine someone commits a crime and then immediately they'll just go and like snort something and then just be like, I shouldn't be held responsible for what I did because, you know what I mean? And again, this man was pursuing an acting career. He was making content for social media. He served in the military. This man was perfectly capable of controlling his actions when he wanted to and when it served him. And he was also perfectly capable of doing whatever he wanted to this sweet Anna when it served him and when he wanted to. And here's the thing. This bitch wasn't on an ounce of blow during the trial. Not a whiff, sniff, or a speck of white passed by those busted ass nostrils. After he eliminated Anna and Ray, he still has a raging, controlling, nasty ego where he thinks he's above everything and that he can shout his way, yell his way towards not guilty. Like, so this snot bucket, the man who took the lives of innocent and never forgotten Anna and Ray, makes sure that everyone in the courtroom gets a taste of his BS attitude when the lawyer for the prosecution mentions his internet searches for escorts and dismembered body parts during his cross-examination.
Web searches from your cell phone. There's a page in front of you as well, page 57. You started searching for escorts on September 6, 2021, correct?
Try to remember what I was doing at that time.
It's not about remembering, it's about looking at the exhibit. These are the web searches from your cell phone. You were searching for escorts on September 6th of 2021.
I don't recall doing that.
Correct?
It's there, but I don't recall doing that.
And Chris Faison was not visiting you then, right?
No.
And then turning to People's 176, page 58, this is another list of searches for escorts on your cell phone, correct?
Sure.
Over and over again, you're searching for escorts, correct?
Okay.
Correct?
Yeah, sure. I was alone.
And People's 176, page 12, this is another list of you searching for escorts on October 2nd of 2021, correct?
That would probably be the night when Chris was there.
Looking at People's 176, page 59, this is another list of you searching for escorts on October 11th, 2021, correct?
Correct.
So there were at least four different dates that you and your phone searched for escorts.
Mm-hmm.
While you claim to be in love with and married to Anna, correct?
That's not even relevant. My love for Anna doesn't change the fact that I was lonely. I was very lonely. She was not in the house. She was gone. She was confusing me about the status of our relationship. I have needs, but I looked them up, but I never hired one. There's no evidence that I hired one ever.
I have needs, but I've never hired one. Listen, yeah, also remember this guy cheated on her? Yeah, remember all of that? Perfectly able to cheat, right? But no, we're not done. This man just wants to belly flop fully in the cesspool.
You were also researching teen videos, correct?
What? What did you just say?
That's what you were researching, correct?
Say it again?
Teen videos.
You're out of your mind.
On October 19th, you were researching Sean Torres, correct?
Show me the teen you just said. You want to pay me some kind of fucking child molester? Show me. What you just said. I've never seen that in the discovery. I've been incarcerated 3 years. You never showed that to my team. Where did you get that?
It's in your phone.
Do it. Show it.
You researched Sean Torres on October 19th.
Show me what you just said. You were not going to breeze over that. You're not going to paint me as something I'm not.
Who the hell are you yelling at, bro? Like, the actual whole grain audacity. Even the posture that this pinochle sits in, and you can really see on display what this specimen of a person must have been like to live with, but also way worse in private, right? Like, the way that he challenges the prosecutor as if he, you know, just like owns the courtroom, bro. And the moment that he's asked about something he doesn't like, he's yelling. He's puffing his chest and he's waving his fingers and making demands and play that, all of this stuff. And I can't even imagine what Anna must have had to endure with him. This is how he thinks he can behave. Again, if he keeps proclaiming the mental illness thing because of the drugs. And it's like, obviously, you know, in instances with people who have addiction issues, if that's what he's saying that he had, like, we show compassion. Like, can be addiction is a disease for many people. But look what he's done. And look how he is just in the courtroom when he's not on the drugs. The drugs were, maybe it exacerbated the problem, but the drugs weren't the problem. It's his ego, his arrogance, his controlling nature. He threatened to deport his wife when she's like, look, I need to get out of this. Let's just go our separate ways. And he's like, I'll have you deported. That is abusive, coercive control 101. And I'm just not going to entertain this guy's excuses. I'm not. And this is him a little later. Another day in the courtroom, another yelling outburst.
Inject your own.
We're going to need a break. Mr. Fullabot, I need you to stop. Mr. Fullabot, I need you to stop. Mr. Fullabot, I need you to stop.
Like, he's yelling so loud, it's hard to understand what he's saying here, but, you know, I am fluent in reading the rage of idiots, so let me translate. At the very end, Ali says, my life is destroyed, and I just gotta ask, whose fault is that?
Show me the teen just said. You wanna pay me some kind of show me.
For everyone watching, it was obvious they were dealing with a man who was either in full-blown control of his emotions or very likely didn't give a to even try because he thought he was above everyone else. Because men like this, excuse me, abusers and murderers like this often think that they're above everything and everyone and can do and say what they want while the rest of the world should cater to them. Now, any small jokes aside, y'all know, again, petty, my coping mechanism. Sometimes I can't help myself when it comes to the dragging of the a-holes for filth. But let's also remember lives have been stolen. Lives have been destroyed. And I don't mean Ali's, even though he wants you to just focus on his life now. Now, it's not just the tragic loss of Anna and Ray, but her daughter is left without a mother and now has an awful father behind bars, though that part is likely, obviously, I think, for the daughter's best interest. This man should never be allowed to be around children, ever. Anna's family has also lost a sister, a daughter, a friend. Friends and family of Ray have lost a young man who was just trying to help his friend through an abusive relationship. Like, there's no true sense of justice to be won here, no matter what the outcome of Ali's sentence. But what's obvious to me in these courtroom clips is that Ali needs to be the center of attention, even when he's literally on trial for a double murder. So, of course, in an unusual decision, of course, you would expect Ali himself, excuse me, this specimen himself, took the stand to give a statement, and he had the crocodile tears ready because you know what this person said? When he was asked about what happened when he barged into the apartment and saw Anna on the couch next to Rayburn, he says this.
What happened next?
I didn't expect that Anna would ever do that to me.
I didn't ever expect Anna to do that to me. Whew, my blood is just percolating. This specimen who has already confessed, remember, he's already confessed to his mom, who verifiably took Anna's life, who verifiably took Ray's life. His first move is to blame Anna for what happened. Ain't that the most classic abusery bullshit? it. He blames her in trial, and he's not done blaming her because he's going to keep blaming her and two more things that we're going to talk about. But you see why I have no sympathy for this guy. Generally, I try to reserve some sympathy. Someone coming from a broken household like he was, like, I try to reserve that. But I can have sympathy for the child that this guy was when he was a child. My sympathy is there for the kid. No kid should have to endure what allegedly his growing up was like. So my sympathy is for the kid. My sympathy is not for this grown-ass man blaming his literal victims, who literally cannot be here to speak for themselves. They cannot defend themselves, and why is that, bro?
Him, of all people. I mean, she knew how I felt about him. She knew how I felt. I was trying to believe her.
So he just keeps blaming Anna, and you know what I keep thinking, besides the fact that they were separated? I keep thinking, you know, he's like, I never thought she would do this to me. I bet Anna didn't ever expect you to abuse her like you did. I bet Anna didn't expect you to take their lives like you did. But, you know, all you can think about is how your life is ruined, dude. Oh, right, it's her fault. Right, okay, yeah, uh-huh.
I couldn't take it. I couldn't take the betrayal. I couldn't believe that she could do that to me, to our daughter. And before I could stop myself, I just f***ing snapped, and my gun was in my hand, and next thing I'm shooting, and I can't stop. I'm shooting, and I'm even startled. It's like I'm watching it happen. I'm like, I'm in the passenger seat of my own body. I can't stop it, and I hear Anna screaming and crying. And I don't even remember shooting Anna. I just remember running back to the front door, and I grabbed the door handle, and then it hit me. I'm like, did that just happen? I don't know. I didn't mean to do that.
This dude who literally cheated on her, who was literally looking up escorts a month before, this dude wants the jury to feel sorry for him because Anna had a friend who is a man while they're separated. Like, the jilted lover defense didn't even work for Betty Broderick, who had a seriously complex case. There's no way it was gonna work for this man whose name shall be ignored. Now, defendants are usually discouraged from taking the stand because it only serves to further implicate them. And, you know, well, let's just say that his statements didn't exactly win over the jury. But aside from his many, what are we gonna call these? Meltdowns, ego downs in court, the evidence against him was pretty damning, especially because he loved to record himself at all times of the day. And I'm not talking just about TikTok. He loved to record himself saying all kinds of awful, awful stuff. And the prosecution, what do you think they did? Yeah, prosecution played these incriminating recordings like the soundtrack to the horror movie that he wanted to direct. I'll give you Exhibit A.
I am the best man you ever met.
You know, funny thing is, it doesn't really look like he's enjoying listening to his performance here. Though I would be remiss if I didn't mention that this smug specimen laughs at one point while the recordings were played.
Abulaban laughed as they were played. Later on, he appeared uncomfortable, telling his attorney to turn it off.
Do you remember when I showed clips from that unhinged jailhouse interview that happened just before his trial? Towards the end of that interview, the reporter asks a brilliant question. It was such a good question. Could anyone else have Anna? And his answer?
Could anyone else have Anna? Could anyone else have Anna?
Not while she's married to me.
Not while she's married to me. Like a piece of property that he destroyed for no reason other than his own ego. It's just absolutely chilling. I know I said I wasn't gonna say his name. I'm gonna say it one more time because I think this sentence deserves his name. Ali Abulaban was sentenced to the maximum of life without parole, in addition to 50 years to life for using a gun. In the words of the judge, Ali Abulaban will die in prison. But before all was said and done, Ali came forward with a final statement, one that I hesitate to call an apology. Just take a listen, and I think you'll see what I mean.
Good morning, everyone. In a situation like this, there really isn't much a person can say that could help make things better. Losing a loved one to senseless and unnecessary violence isn't something that anyone should have to go through. And yet, it has happened.
I'm sorry. You you can't imagine how painful it is to have to lose a family member like this. Like, bro, I'm just like, you murdered them. You took their lives. They don't ever get to have another day on this earth. Like, why is it always about you?
Throughout this trial, many horrific things were displayed. And as we sat here for weeks, having to endure some of the most disturbing audio recordings and video footage, I sat there in silence, listening, watching, and being reminded of the worst moments of my life. Having to hear myself say some of the most vile, shocking, and hateful things to the woman I love was not easy. In fact, I couldn't help but at times close my eyes and cover my ears, because that's not who I am. My behavior was disgusting and completely unacceptable. So when the time came for me to take the stand, I tried as best as I could to help make some sense of all this, to explain that everything you all saw in the last few months leading up to this incident was a horrific result of the tragic downfall to a once beautiful relationship.
This apology, like, it's all focused on his trauma, his mental health, how he had to replay the worst moments of his life sitting there in trial, listening to his own recordings and words of what he was saying to Anna. Again, me, my, oh my God, it's me, everyone feel bad for me.
On that day of October 21st, 2021, I was in the worst physical and mental state of my life. My response in that moment was an unintended, impulsive reaction against my better judgment to the discovery of Ray's romantic involvement with my wife. And for that, I'm sorry. I'm sorry that in that moment, I was not mentally strong enough to control myself.
He also, like, visibly gets annoyed when someone in the gallery makes a squeaky chair sound.
Rayburn Barone and Anna Marie Abunaba.
Like, dude is just on, he's on another dimension with his arrogance.
He wrapped up his statement by saying the jury got the case wrong, that it was actually a crime of passion and not a cold-blooded premeditated murder.
It is truly unfortunate that despite the compelling evidence that this was a crime of passion, somehow the jury still landed on this verdict, and they certainly wasted no time in doing so. The fact that I spent more time on the stand than the jury took to deliberate my fate is very concerning. I think that speaks for itself, loud and clear, that reasonable doubt was intentionally overlooked, and that justice was not the motivating factor behind their decision. It was vengeance. And now I am left with no other option but to spend the rest of my life in prison, death by incarceration, a very slow and drawn-out death sentence. That means that 50 years from now, should I still be alive, I would still not be considered for release. I don't think that's fair at all.
So he literally, like, says he's sorry, but also he says that spending his life in prison without parole isn't right and isn't fair. L-O-F-ing-L, dude. And when you listen to the sentencing statement, it sounds like the judge agreed that this person was very disingenuous.
I've watched him here during all of this time. He's a very talented actor. He is a very talented actor. Yeah. When I saw the Scarface videos, it's as if when he committed these crimes, he became that persona of Scarface, of just the cold-blooded killing without remorse. Any tears that he's cried in this courtroom have been for himself. They are not for Ray and Anna. It's just, that's the reality. He fears the consequences, as he should, of his actions. But as he sits here today, I don't know if he's really sorry. I have serious reservations about it.
I think the judge nails this dude in his sentencing speech, calling him a very talented actor, which, I mean, debatable, the TikTok stuff, but calls him cold-blooded. And when the judge says that any tears cried are not for the victims, I think he's spot on. Let me know what you think in the comments about what the judge said. No matter how emotional his earlier apology might have appeared, I personally think that he's just kind of full of shit, because his reactions during the judge's sentencing to me say it all.
That's who he is. He's somebody that is only thinking about himself, and the idea of killing two innocent people doesn't disturb him. It's chilling. So the bottom line here is he will die in prison. He will never be a free man. He will take his last breath. In this, please.
Y'all, literally, I am clapping right along with everyone else. Like, if you want to sneer at the victims' families and mock them, then we'll leave you with the same sentiment. Freedom, straight to prison for life. Like, there are consequences for your actions. And, you know, a round of applause again for the judge seeing right through his BS and giving their families at least, hopefully, like a sliver of a feeling of justice, even though sadly, obviously, it will never bring back Anna and Rayburn. Now, remember how we went over how he just blames everyone and everything except himself. He blames the drugs. He blamed Anna. He blamed Rayburn. He blamed everything. Everyone, right? Blames everyone all the time. He blamed her in recordings. He blamed her in his testimony in trial. He blamed her in that interview. Well, literally just a couple of days ago from the time of me filming this, this dude uploads a new YouTube video to his channel. Now, I don't know who actually pushed upload because I certainly hope he doesn't have access to YouTube, but I don't know how that works. But literally a new video has been uploaded to his channel. I'm gonna pull it up right here. It is titled Murder or Manslaughter? Aliyah Aboulibon Trial Recap. And the beginning of this video starts with his apology stuff, right? The stuff where he's still talking about, but me and
good morning, everyone. In a situation like this, there really isn't much a person could say that could help make things better.
And then it plays his reaction listening to the judge who's reading him for filth.
I've watched him here during all of this time. He's a very talented actor. He is a very talented actor.
And then he puts this text on screen. So he puts in this video, not sorry, and then doesn't disturb me,
That's who he is. He's somebody that is only thinking about himself, and the idea of killing two innocent people doesn't disturb him. It's chilling.
I didn't expect that Anna would ever do that to me.
And the fact that there's this slow, emotional music playing underneath, he's literally still, even after being sentenced, after everyone cheers, after the judge saying he will die in prison, this man still is avoiding taking accountability for his actions. And that's why I don't have sympathy here. This is next level BS, arrogant, frightening, keep him off the streets, never let him be anywhere near his daughter behavior. And then after those questions, doesn't disturb me, then they play with the soft, somber music underneath, clips of his attorney literally blaming Anna. They bring up again, oh, she must have been cheating on him. She must have done something.
Today is September 23rd. Anna took Ali to the airport. And again, I love yous are exchanged. And he takes off for Miami. And while he's in Miami, out of nowhere, Anna blocks him. He can't reach her, he can't find out what's happening, and Anna knows the impact that this will have on Ali. It makes him absolutely crazy. And she does it often and with reckless abandon to hurt him and to torture him.
She must have, you know, she was a terrorist. She drove him to do this to her and to Rayburn. It's all Anna, you know, like, it just blows my mind that he would literally have this video edited together, like right after he's sentenced to die for the rest of his life in prison. They blame her again. He blames her again.
Ali was provoked by Anna's months of confusion, her infidelity, and deceit. And he was provoked by Ray's involvement with Anna on October 21st of 2021.
This is just so unbelievable to me, and it makes me so angry. I know I have like a smile on my face because this is a smile of extreme frustration. Sometimes I do that when I get so mad at something. Who edited this video? That's what I wanna know, actually. Who edited this video together? Who put that somber ass, piano ass music underneath to try to make this feel so sentimental and so touching? Who put that together? And then it cuts to him talking about, you know, the fact that I spent more time on the stand than the jury spent deliberating, and it's like, dude, why do you think that might be? Why do you think it didn't take the jury long to come to their verdict? Could it possibly be because all of the evidence stacked upon itself. Everything that you did, not just that fateful day, but everything that you did and recorded, and all these awful things that you recorded yourself saying to her so freely, maybe all of that evidence piled on top of each other told the jury, this man should never be free again. Is that so hard? They wanted manslaughter. They wanted this to be a crime of passion. But I'm wondering, how are you gonna argue a crime of passion when he literally put a spying app on the iPad waiting for this type of thing, and then he grabbed his gun, had all of this time to think about, should I get a gun or should I not? The answer would be you should not. He had to drive. He had all this time to think about it, but he wants this to be manslaughter. He wants the lightest sentencing possible, put on parole, and then out. And that's just wild to me. And so then this video ends with, you know, this was a crime of passion, tragic response in the heat of the moment, like all of the, I just like, and it's like, you have a long-standing history of DV. You have a long-standing history of putting this sweet Anna through the absolute worst, to where she couldn't take it anymore. She shouldn't have never had to take any of it, but she did. She stood by you for a long time. And then she couldn't do it anymore. And she got herself and her daughter out. That's the history. You wanna call this passion? What was all of that? What was all of that? That's all I gotta ask him. If I ever talk to him, which why would I talk to him? But if I ever interviewed this guy, what was all of that? This was passion? Okay, we'll go with that for a second. What was all of this? I don't know. You tell me, sir. But it's a good thing that your video on YouTube is monetized. At least you have that. As for the families of Anna and Ray, they made statements outside the courtroom that they were pleased with the outcome of the trial, and while it won't bring their loved ones back, it felt as though they could finally rest a little.
This was the best we could hope for, and we just thank God that our prayers have been answered, and now we can all rest.
So just to bring the focus back on to Anna and Rayburn, the only people who matter here, because the monster is in the cage. Anna had a full life ahead of her. She had a beautiful little daughter to shower with love, a budding social media career, friends who loved her, family who cherished her, and a community that needed her. And Rayburn was just as loved. Here's something that was written about Rayburn from those who loved him the most. Rayburn was an amazing brother, son, nephew, cousin, and friend who touched all the lives around him. Rayburn dedicated his life to always putting his family first. In many ways, he was the glue to his family, always reaching out to family to bring everyone closer. He was a loyal friend who you could always count on to be there in time of need. Ray made an impact on so many lives with his love and his thoughtful acts. At the end of the day, I think as far as legally speaking, justice was done here. I can't believe that this video came out, but we can just put all of that away now and just focus on these people and their wonderful lives that were cut far too short. And I hope that in time, while this sentencing can't bring back Anna and Rayburn, that no matter what, that the memories of Anna and Rayburn will always be a blessing. Okay, Suspirians, it's time to step out of the dark waters of the Suspool. Grab a towel and dry off. That's what I got. Please do excuse the tone shift. I know the story got a little heavy, but I think these types of stories are important to talk about and to just keep front of mind that there are signs of people's behavior. If there's someone controlling in your life, please do reach out to someone that you trust or reach out to one of those free resources and just understand that you do have options. There is a way to get out. I hope that you're safe. So yeah, please excuse the tone shift. If you want to hear more stories like this, be sure to subscribe to this channel and go ahead and tickle the like button for more. And let me know in the comments if you have any specific stories that you would like us to dip into, whether it's true crime or true crime adjacent, or some maybe a lighter Karen stories, or some dips into some public figures being weird. Also, I heard all of the requests. I heard y'all, and we have officially launched memberships on this channel and my main channel. So many of you have been asking for a very long time to have memberships. So this is a way, if you just want to do additional support of the channel. Again, you do not have to. Please know that you do not have to. I appreciate all of you being here. The content is always going to remain free. Nothing is going to change. This just gives those of you who were interested some extra additional things, like special badges that will attach to your profile. And you can have some special customized emojis when you're leaving comments. And we'll have some like special membership polls and questions and all of that type of thing. things. So if you want to join the memberships, those are now open. Thank you so much for being patient. I'm sorry it took so long to make them, but they are there for anyone who wants them. But again, you don't have to. I'm just happy that you're all here. And also I want to give a huge thank you to all our patron members. We're getting ready to do a whole new overhaul over there. A lot of stuff has been centered around like short films and music, and we're just going to do a new overhaul. And I appreciate all of our Patreon producers for being here. Also, you can follow me on Instagram and Twitter, linked below. That's where I post most often daily. I try to, and also announce opportunities to have your thoughts featured in my deep dives, in little interviews and questionnaires on my main channel, Swoop. I do have a brand new full deep dive Swoop documentary out on my main channel, Swoop. It is linked below and in the pinned comment as well. I highly recommend that you check that out after this. Also, of course, you can grab your very own pieces from the Valid Ribcage and Valid Social Club collections in the Petty University shop that's linked below as always. I do hope that you enjoy just having some clothing with some positive reinforcing messaging that hopefully makes you feel good. I love getting the DMs and the photos and everything of you sharing how just good the clothing makes you feel. That was why I designed it. I just wanted something positive out in the world because there's just a lot of darkness. Again, if you're interested in those pieces are still available, and we have some official Suspool apparel also coming very soon. It's been a long process, y'all. We had to delay the launch a number of times. And of course I took a bit of a break for my own just mental health and stuff. And so that delayed things. So just thank you for your patience. I'm so excited. Be sure to check out Factor 75 and head to factor75.com or click the link below and use code SWOOP250 to get 50% off your first Factor box and 20% off your next month of orders. That's code SWOOP250, that's SWOOP T-O-O-5-0 at factor75.com to get 50% off your first box plus 20% off your next month of orders. Treat yourself, honey. You deserve it. Thanks for coming on a swim. Have a good day out there. Keep it creepy, keep it cute, stay safe, and I will see you next time in the Suspool. Swoop!